Hey guys, good morning. I hope you all are having a wonderful day today. I hope you guys are having a blessed day, an awesome day. And guys, even if you feel that you're not, I always say think of the things that just do an inventory of your life and really appreciate the things that you do have. Because sometimes where you think that you're lacking and what you think you may need more of, somebody wish they had what you had. If you look at this world, you look at the things that's going on all over, thank God that you're not traffic. Thank God that you're not burying your child. Thank God that you are not living under a bridge. Thank God that you are not standing on the corner asking for food. Thank God that you are not running from place to place trying to find shelter and trying to avoid genocide. Thank God that you are not a victim of kidnapping. Thank God that you are not somewhere being tortured to death. Thank God that you are not somewhere that you are just powerless and you have to watch your children being taken from you. Thank God that you're not a victim of false allegations. Thank God that you are not a victim of mistaken identity. Thank God that you are not falsely arrested. Thank God, thank God, thank God, thank God, thank God that your house didn't burn to the ground. Thank God that you are not in getting chemotherapy. Thank God if you have overcome chemotherapy. Thank God if you're alive. Think about the things and the sicknesses and the diseases that you could have had or you've had before and God healed you. Thank God that you are alive, that you didn't die when you were ejected from that vehicle. Thank God that you survived a car accident, that you were supposed to be dead. There's no way that you should have walked out of there unharmed. Thank God there was someone there to help you in the line when maybe you came up short on your card for payment. Thank God, thank God, thank God, thank God for what you have. Thank God that you have a cell phone. It may be a flip phone, but it's still a phone. It may be an old phone, but it's still a phone. Thank God you have one chair versus no chairs. If you're sitting on the floor, thank God you have a floor to sit on, because there's people that's outside with no floor, no roof. Whatever, wherever you're at in your life, believe me, you're doing better than some. I love to watch shows about how people live in different parts of the world. I watch things, you know, from the people of Nepal and all of that, just seeing how they live. And, you know, to us being in Western civilization, you'd be like, wow, you know, you're looking at them starting a fire. They have a hearth going in the middle of the floor and they have to do so many things to prepare their food. And while to us it may seem like, wow, to some, you know, they're so much more resourceful than we are. We don't know how to start any fires, maybe to some degree, but these individuals, they are survivors, you know? But anyway, the point that I was making was, I don't know, maybe to some people they'll look at even their people who may live in a setting that's not, you know, it's not fancy houses like we're used to. And maybe, I'm not saying they are, but maybe someone will look at someone else's place and think, oh, well, that place looks very poor. But, you know, I was thinking they have a roof over their head. Because there's people who are in more developed societies, if you want to call it more developed, that's on the streets. But yet they have a place to sleep, to cook, to wash. And my point is, we all have something that somebody wishes they have. You may hate your legs, but somebody has no legs that would want your legs. You may hate your toes and your feet, but there's somebody with no toes and no feet. You may not like your nose, but there's somebody who has suffered from a flesh-eating bacteria that's eaten their nose and was working its way up into their brain. So stop, whoever you are, stop complaining about your body and what you don't have, because I guarantee you there's somebody in a situation they will gladly take your face. They'll gladly take your nose, your hands, your fingers, your toes, your body, your complexion, whatever it is that you're complaining about, somebody wishes they have it. And you know what? Continuing to complain about things like that, you don't want to be in a situation where you regret it and you're wishing you had even that. So guys, what I want to talk to y'all about today is spiritual blindness. And we're going to talk about individuals that you may see them just really, they say that they're Christians, but they're really doing things that are so opposite of what a Christian should be doing or what a believer of the Lord should be doing. They are living a life and doing things that's opposite of what the Word of God says, but you see them take the Word of God and twist it to fit their narrative and to fit what they want in their situations. You may see well-known pastors that you've known from the days of old that they have gone so far left, it's hard to recognize them, and you hear them justifying their behavior, lifestyles, choices, who they're associated with. And you see them use the exact same word of God to promote or condone sin or to be neutral about sin. They will say, well, God is a God of love, so they're not going to talk about sin. But yet the Bible does talk about and address sin. The Bible does not say, well, I love you, so I'm not going to look at your sin. The Bible says, I love you enough to call you out on your sin. That's what the Bible teaches us. I'm giving you every opportunity to turn away from your sin. I do not wish to bring my judgment on you. I do not wish to be separated from you or to separate you from me. However, the Bible does tell us about the consequences of sin. But these individuals, when they're asked about specific things, lifestyle choices, they will jump on, well, God is a God of love. There was a preacher that spoke about homosexuality. He was asked about it. Excuse me, guys. And he specifically said, he got very defensive. I'm not going to touch that. I'm not going to talk about that because Jesus doesn't talk about that in the New Testament. He doesn't once mention it. Okay. Well, we know that according to John 17, Jesus speaks, he does his final prayer, or at least the last recorded prayer to God. And one of the things that he says is, we are one. He lets it be known that he is one with the Father. He is one with God. Okay? He says, he makes that very clear. And so God in the Old Testament spoke about homosexuality and it being a sin. He speaks about that and the consequences. He speaks about many things. It's not just homosexuality. He speaks about men laying with men, women laying with women, men laying with beasts, laying with your child. I mean, all these things are there. And so what we have to understand is there are certain things that Jesus doesn't mention it, but it does not mean, there's lots of things that Jesus doesn't mention. I mean, he does not mention that that raping children is wrong. Jesus does not mention specifically raping the elderly is wrong. He does not mention in the New Testament that you cannot go and hack somebody to pieces, you know? But what he does also speak about is he has not come to do away with the laws, all right? That's something that Jesus speaks about in the New Testament, but that the laws may be fulfilled. So when this pastor sat on this platform and said what he said, it was kind of amazing. But what you find a lot of people, especially when they become what you call celebrity pastors, which in my humble opinion should not even be said. Celebrity and pastors just don't go together. But I digress. So they have to save face because they're getting funding and money and they know so many different people. They are, if you want to say sleeping with the enemy, so you can't offend the enemy. If the enemy is funding me, I can't upset that person. If you don't even want to say the enemy, all right? If I know, and I know that I've decided that I'm going to do some shady business, per se, with a company, or I'm getting money from a company that, yeah, they believe in, let's say they believe in making animal sacrifice, but they're actually been funding me and helping my company and helping my brand, and they're financing me big time. And they're getting me connections with other people that's helping to put more money in my pockets, give me a bigger platform, give me some international connections and all of that. If I'm sitting on a platform and a person is asking me, well, you know, what do you think about animal sacrifices? Well, I have a lot of things to think about here. If I say that animal sacrifice is wrong, I'm going to offend those who are funding me, those who are giving me the platform, those who have given me international connections, and that's going to be bad for me. So what you find is a lot of these pastors are changing the narrative. And what they do is, rather than just stand by their claims on their own and say, well, yeah, I don't think there's anything wrong with it, or no, I don't think anything's wrong with it, or whatever else, they want a whole God in it. And so what they do is they ignore the Bible, ignore certain things in the Bible. And then I'm going to find the chapter and the scriptures about love and forgiveness and God is a God of grace, but I'm going to ignore the rest. I'm going to ignore the book of Romans, which is one of the other things that this pastor does ignore. The book of Romans that also speaks about, you know, men laying with men, women laying with women. They're going to forget all of that. And he's probably going to say, well, that was not Jesus speaking. It was someone else speaking. But keep in mind, these are the disciples that walked with Jesus. These are disciples that were beaten and flogged, you know, for the gospel after Jesus was crucified. After they saw him resurrected, after they saw him ascend into heaven, they were still being beaten, flogged, threatened. These are men of God who were standing up for the gospel, regardless of who's telling them to be quiet, regardless of who was using their power and their ability to get them cast out of the city. There are all these things going on. So these are courageous men. All right, Paul and other men of old, they were willing to stand strong no matter what. So these are men that were willing to be in, they were at the times subject to possible death, and many of them died horrible deaths. Comparing it to someone who is sitting on a platform afraid to really say what the Word of God says. So this individual will ignore that and say, well, you know, Jesus didn't say that. It was this other person that said that. That's not what he said. But I'm saying, if Romans was brought up, the scripture about if it's okay to have same-sex relationships according to the Bible, he would probably have put a spin on it. And there are lots of people that does that. There's a man by the name of Vody. I don't know the rest of his name, but he got banned from social media, or I don't know if it's temporary, and this is allegedly, because he spoke very openly, biblically, according to the Word of God, what the Lord says about same-sex relationships. And that was a problem. And guys, that's one of the reasons why so many people, a lot of these celebrity preachers, they're not going to talk about things like that. They're not going to talk about things like that because they don't want that type of backlash. They see what happens when you speak the word of God. But the word of God told us that we're going to be persecuted and we're going to be reviled for standing up for Christ. For the word's sake, we're going to be reviled. But there are lots of people, celebrity pastors, that don't want to be reviled and persecuted for the word's sake. They want to be celebrated. So they go and look for the good stuff in the word to talk about without. And honestly, it may seem like they're trying to be politically correct, but what they're doing is they're literally leaving a person in darkness and sin to die in their sins because they're saying it's okay. And there's some people, they may really maybe want to know the truth, but if someone says that, then they feel like, okay, I'm good. So they continue doing what they want to do. And then there are others that, yeah, tell me what I want to hear. And so they remain in darkness. Either way, it's going to fall not only on that person that's choosing to be ignorant, but those leaders. So let's deviate away from leaders for a while. Let's just look at your regular, everyday believer, someone that you may see at work that say that they're Christians, and you may see them in the neighborhood and they say that they're Christians, but they're doing the exact same thing as an unsaved person. They are in the same circles as the unsaved person. They're doing the exact same things. And what will they do? They use the word of God to manipulate and say, well, Jesus sat with sinners. Jesus was sitting with sinners. Yes, he was. But let's put it like this. They came to Jesus and they sat with him and he sat with them. But he was always the one that was the influencer. It wasn't the other way around. So there's people that will say that they're Christians and believers and they do everything like the sinner. They get turned up, meaning they're out partying, which is, I forgot the word that's in the Bible for that. I'll think about it. They're partying. They're in sexual sin. They're having sexual conversations. They're doing everything just like how somebody else will do it. Yes, we all have to go to work like everybody else go to work. We all have to take a bus or a car or some vehicle like everyone else. But choices, things that has to do with sexual, things with morality in your character. There are people who are just the same sexual deviant as they were before. Or they are using profanity just the same. There are people who will be preaching the gospel and at the same time, they're cursing. They are to a place where they're defending sin. They are like, you know, they protect sin. So when they do wrong, they're defensive about their sin, not about the fact that they have sinned. More so, rather than being saying to themselves, you know, right, I shouldn't be this way, they're going to defend it and say only God could judge me. So you want God to judge you on profanity? You want God to judge you on sleeping around? You want God to judge you on lying? If you are still behaving this way, when you get before God, you are going to be sentenced. You'll be judged and sentenced for those sins because the Bible says it's sin. I think people need to understand that when a brother or sister in the Lord that really has the right heart, okay, because that's important, because some people, they don't have the right heart. They just want to be malicious. But when a brother or sister with a right heart comes to you and they make something known, that is God using someone to give you an olive branch to get things right. First of all, before anybody comes to talk to, when before God uses you or God sends someone to talk to you, if you're the one doing something wrong, God has already put it in that person's heart. He's already put it in your heart that what you're doing is wrong, that the way that you're behaving is incorrect. He already does that. He's already done that, all right? And so then he begins to send someone to you, or you may hear something like this video. This is the Lord giving you an olive branch, because God used people. If you look in the Bible, God will send his prophets. God will send someone to give a warning. Hey, turn around, make this change. So before it gets to that point where someone is asked, saying something to you, God has already spoken to these individuals, right? And what will happen is they become defensive about the sin because they know it's wrong. They have heard it before. They have felt like it was wrong when they were doing it, but they have gotten to the habit of sinning so much that they begin to become numb to the convictions of God, because the further away you go from God, the more darker your heart becomes, and what you used to feel guilty about, now you feel justified. There's going to be a narrative that these individuals would have told themselves as far as why they're doing what they're doing. And they will also compare themselves to someone else and say, well, I'm not as bad as this person, or I'm not as bad as I was before. And you have to think, if someone went and stood before a judge, they can't say to the judge, well, Your Honor, I don't rob as many houses as I did before, but you're still robbing. So you're going to be sentenced for that. There are going to be consequences for it. Lord, I'm not as bad as this next person. But as you notice, when people stand before a judge, he does not have the murderer, the robber, the child molester, the violent, the angry person. They're not all standing before the judge, and the judge is going, well, let's see, you know what, you can get off because you're not doing as bad as this person. You're still going to stand before the judge. These individuals are still going to stand before the judge for what they did, because it's not about to what degree you're doing it, but that it's a crime. It's a crime. It's a crime. So when it comes to the things of God, we cannot be comparing ourselves to say, well, I'm not as bad as I was before, and I'm not as bad as this person, because the fact is there's still sin. And so these individuals will be saying, only God can judge me. But God is going to send people to speak to you after he's already spoken to you. He's already shown you in the word of God it's wrong. He's going to send people. He's going to do that. You're going to see things on a video. You'll see things on a billboard. Somebody that's not even normally a Christian will say something to these individuals, because God gives them every opportunity before his judgment. But they will twist the scripture. So people who sin a lot on purpose, habitually, sin changes their heart and their eyes become darkened and blind. So don't be surprised when, no matter how much you're talking to them, they are ignoring the word that says sin is wrong verbatim. They are ignoring that, and they want to find gray areas. Don't be surprised when you find them taking the Bible and twisting the word of God to fit what they want, while ignoring other parts of the Bible that says verbatim, this is wrong. Don't be surprised when people will say, well, this is not in the Bible, so why can't I do it? The Bible doesn't say we can't live together verbatim. Well, does it say you can live together verbatim in the Bible? The Bible doesn't say I can't smoke. Well, does it say that you can smoke? So it's still the same situation. No, it doesn't say that you shouldn't smoke, but it doesn't say that you should smoke. But even without that being in the Bible, that you should smoke, you're inclined to smoke and say, well, the word doesn't say anything about it. So it really boils down to the position and the condition of the heart. And sometimes it can be scary to see how people will change the word. And that's why it's important that you are studying and reading the word of God for yourself. And then you ask God to show you what is truth. Because the way the enemy is coming, he's masquerading as an angel of light. So because they're masquerading, what's going to happen is they will be sounding like they're of God. They're going to be preaching a lot of actual legitimate messages, and they'll be quoting things that's legitimate, and it's going to touch the heart because the Word of God is going to touch people's heart. The Word of God is excellent. The Word of God is quick and powerful, so it's going to work. It's like you give a murderer a pencil and they write with it. The pencil is going to function as it should because it's a pencil. It doesn't matter that this is a killer writing versus you give it to, and you give it to someone who is an upstanding citizen, the pencil is still going to do what it's going to do. So it's the same thing with the Word of God. So the Word of God is quick and powerful. So someone whose heart is not right with God can really preach a message that moves you in everything, because the Word is powerful. Their gifts that God gives to them, the gift of orator, of being an orator, the gift of prophecy, whatever, all that's going to work. But it doesn't mean that it's coming from God. Anything that God gives is going to perform to excellence, but it is completely different. It's separated from that person. When the person leaves, their gifts of prophecy and all that stuff is not going to be standing before God. The soul will stand before God. The gifts and the functions that God gives to us, that's not going to be anymore. That's not going to matter. That's why people will stand before God according to Jesus's word in Matthew 7. People going to say, Lord, Lord, didn't we do this? Didn't we do this? That has nothing to do with you. Prophecy has nothing to do with who you are as a soul. Singing and dancing before God has nothing to do with your soul. You're going to be asked about yourself, especially when there's sin involved. So these individuals will be turning the Word of God and ignoring the rest of the Bible that says you shouldn't do it, because that's what their heart is inclined to do. So you find the blind leading the blind. Why is it that people will say that they believe in God while still living like a sinner on purpose? Because they're blind. Why is it that they reject correction? Because they're blind. Why are they blind? They choose to be blind. Because it's one thing if you've never known God, but it's another thing to have known the Word and to hear the Word of God and continue to sin and pick what you want. Pick what you want to believe. And the Bible says that. If you trod the sacrifice of Jesus underfoot, you trod grace and mercy underfoot and use it for sin, and you'll find that, I believe it's in Hebrews chapter 10. If you read all of Hebrews chapter 10, you will see that there's a greater condemnation for those, a greater sin for those who knew God, knew the truth, and turn around and do what they want to do. Those, according to Romans 1, who holds the truth of God in unrighteousness, and not only do these sins, but they encourage and rejoice in others who do these sins. So when you're truly following God and want to live in holiness and righteousness, and then you look and see somebody else that said that they're Christians, and they're just turning up, doing whatever they want to do and justifying it, you're looking at a dead man walking. You're looking at a blind person. They choose to be blind. They choose to put on blinders. They choose to live how they want to live. And that's pretty much what it is. So I'm going to stop here. Sin will lead you to spiritual blindness. And suddenly what's going to happen is what you've known is wrong, suddenly it's going to be right. What you know is not wrong, you're going to compare yourself. These people compare themselves to others. What they know is wrong, suddenly they're going to gloss over it, ignore the scriptures that say that sin is wrong, and look for something about God's grace is sufficient. And that's the danger of it. Sometimes people will sin, and they sin and like, and yes, I'm sinning, and what? It is what it is. I don't believe in God, and la la la. I've seen people do that on social media, and it's kind of like, are you hurting me by behaving that way? Are you hurting me by saying, I don't believe in your God? That has nothing to do with me. It's like someone saying, yeah, that's right. It is what it is. And then they're the ones that's walking on broken glass and, you know, about to walk into an inferno. That's not hurting me. That's you, you know? So guys, just keep that in mind. People who say that they know God and they're sinning on purpose, they chose that. They're not being overtaken. They're choosing that. And in choosing to ignore the truth of God, it sets them up to be spiritually blind. It's like they're going back to sleep again. They're going back into darkness. And they're going to change the narrative of the Bible. They're going to do all this. And it's really one thing. If you just want to go and sin and do what you want to do, you know, the Lord spoke about that in the book of Ezekiel. It's one thing that you want to go and live your life how you want to live it. But to take my holy name and place it in the midst of your sin and put my holy name on top of your choice of idolatry and sin and abomination, that's where things get really serious for individuals. You want to sin. If these individuals want to sin, then you choose to do that. You go all the way with it. But to drag God's holy name and smacking it on top of these abominations, that brings even a greater damnation. And that is why it's so dangerous. I believe in my heart that Christians and people who say they believe in God, or those who say that they're believers of the Lord, however they identify, they are more dangerous than killer with a machete. Because a killer with a machete, you just gonna know, you see him coming. But this person, this type of individuals, what they will do is they are sinful and wicked, but they hide among the sheep, and they're really a wolf, but they want to seem to be a sheep. And they can use the Bible to manipulate. They use the two-edged sword to cut people asunder. They use the word of God to manipulate people, to make them get confused. They use the word of God to control people and to make people think sin is okay when it's not. And to me, that's the worst kind. So guys, let us keep ourselves clean before God. Ask him to help us, because any of us can turn away and go on the wrong path if we begin to start to think of ourselves as being higher, or if we begin to become lackadaisical in certain things. And so guys, I just want to just encourage you all today and just tell you, when you see them behaving like that, they are lost. Study your word so you don't get lost. Avoid debating with these people, because they know that they're doing something wrong. They're believers. They know it's wrong. They just want to try to change things. People that fall away from God, oftentimes they don't want to go to hell by themselves. And so what they do is they need to take other people. They have to change your mind. They want you to shut up while they can behave how they want to behave. They can believe what they want to believe, but they have a problem with you speaking the word of God. It offends them. And the reason why it grates at their spirit and it will offend them is because they are inhabited by unclean spirits. And if you read in the word of God, whenever there was a person that was possessed with a demon, whenever Jesus came around, they got aggressive. They may not be convulsing to the ground, but one of the one thing about them is that they are aggressive. And that's what it is. They'll get aggressive. They get upset. They'll get riled up and put something mean on your post or say something. That is that unclean spirit that hates truth, hates light, hates correction. So take that stuff with a grain of salt. Don't take it personally, guys. And just know this. In God, God is light. And in him, there is no darkness at all. Anyone says that they know God and walk in darkness, they are a liar and the truth is not in them. All right, guys.